Good evening. Welcome to the solemn service of Tenebrae. When I was in Sunday school, I was taught that somehow Jesus' crucifixion was the worst and most painful suffering ever inflicted on a human being. And that was what made it so special. Even then, that claim sounded a little suspicious, and now that I have sadly acquired a more complete knowledge of man's inhumanity to man, I know for sure that was not true. In fact, it is not Jesus' specialness that gives power to his death. It is his commonality with the many thousands of others who have also died in brutal and undeserved ways. Even on that day, there were at least three crucifixions on Golgotha. He was many through the ages. Jesus joins ordinary humans to take on all the worst we can dish out to one another. And although we may feel abandoned, even as Jesus did, God does not leave us. In fact, as the story reveals, God suffers with us. And so tonight, we commemorate that sad event that takes us into the darkness. We know that all of life is both light and dark, sun and shadow. And tonight, we enter the shadows. Let's prepare for this hour as Rebecca Shrimpton calls us to worship.
Oh.
Please join me in the responsive reading printed in your bulletins. In the darkness of waiting, of not knowing what is to come, we come with trusting hearts, for the darkness and the light are all the same to you. In the darkness of staying silent, the terror of having nothing to say, in the greater terror of needing nothing to say, we turn to you, O God, for the darkness and the light are all the same to you. In the darkness of loving, in which it is safe to surrender, to let go of our self-protection, we cling to you, dearest friend, for the darkness and the light are all the same to you. In the darkness of hoping, in a world which longs for hope, we follow the one who has wrestled with the night, for the darkness and the light are all the same to you. Please stand and sing together Beneath the Cross of Jesus. That's in the black hymnal, number 190.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Come to the depths of your memory, the depths of your fear, the depths of your emptiness. Come to the place of repentance in chosen words and silence. Let us pray together the confession printed in your bulletin. Merciful Christ, whom we long to follow and obey, we have come here out of love, your love for us and ours for you. As we gather this evening to commemorate your darkest hour, we remember the betrayal and abandonment of your friends. Their sorrowful question is on our lips. Is it I? And we know the answer, for we too have denied and turned our backs on you. We have sinned. We have made excuses for our failures. We have neglected to live up to the new commandment that you gave us, to love one another as you have loved us. Forgive us, we pray, and help us to be more faithful. Amen. God's love is boundless and reaches into the unknown and distant places, even the far reaches of our hearts. Be assured that God's mercy is extended to you. God's redemption is very near. Thanks be to Christ, who has become our salvation. Amen. night Jesus celebrated the Passover with his friends in the upper room to share a meal of remembrance. He joined with those first disciples and the church of all time and all places to know Christ in the breaking of the bread. So come then to this table. Bring your broken hearts and your broken dreams. Bring your failures and your fears. And bring also your strengths and your gifts that they may be consecrated to the service of God. Let us pray. Call us by name, O God, with arms outstretched as on a cross. Call us to yourself, and you name us your own people. So with arms outstretched, we yield to you. With arms outstretched, we embrace new possibilities. Bless them this bread and this cup, that they may be nourishment to our souls. Amen. Blessed be our brother Jesus Christ, bone of our bone and flesh of our flesh, who did not turn away from the cup of suffering, but on the night of betrayal and desertion, and on the eve of death, gathered his disciples for the feast of Passover. And on that night, Jesus took the bread. He broke it, saying, "This is my body broken for you." Whatever you do this, remember me. Ministering to you in the name of Jesus Christ, we give you this bread. Thank you. This is the body of Christ, given for you. In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, my life poured out for you and for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink this, do so in remembrance of me, ministering to you in the name of Jesus Christ, who give you this cup." This is the cup of hope. There is no sin too deep to be forgiven. There is no human being too evil to be redeemed. There is no sorrow or pain that is beyond God's healing touch. The cup of hope. Let's stand and sing together, "Just As I Am." It's in the Black Hymnal, number 207.
when it was evening, he took his place with the 12. And while they were eating, he said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me." And they became greatly distressed and began to say to one another, "Surely not I, Lord." He answered, "The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to the one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born." Judas, who betrayed him, said, "Surely not I, Rabbi." Jesus replied, "You have said so."
Then Jesus said to them, "You will all become deserters because of me this night. For it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go ahead of you to Galilee." Peter said to him, "Though all become deserters because of you, I will never desert you." Jesus said to him, "Truly I tell you, this very night, before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times. Peter said to him, "Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you." And so said all the disciples.
Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took with him Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee and began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will it." Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "So, could you not watch with me 1 hour?
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. And with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard." So when he came, he went up to him at once and said, "Rabbi," and kissed him. Then they laid their hands on him and arrested him. Then Jesus said to them, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled." All of them deserted him and fled.
When morning came, all the chief priests and the elders of the people conferred together against Jesus in order to bring about his death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the governor.
Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said, "You have said so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he did not answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many accusations they make against you?" But he gave them no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed.
Now Peter was below in the courtyard. One of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said, "You also were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth." But he denied it, saying, "I do not know or understand what you are talking about." Then the cock crowed, and the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders, "This man is one of them." But again, he denied it.
Then, after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter, "Certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." But he began to curse, and he swore an oath, "I do not know this man you are talking about." At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times." And he broke down and wept.
Then the soldiers led Jesus into the courtyard of the palace, and they called together the whole battalion. They clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some of the thorns into the crown, they put it on him. And they began saluting him, "Hail, King of Jews." They struck his head with a reed, spat on him, knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of his purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him.
And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink, mixed with gall, but when he tasted it, he would not drink it. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews."
Two others also who were criminals were led away to be put to death with Jesus, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And the soldiers cast lots to divide his clothing, and the people stood by watching. But the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others, let him save himself, if he is the Messiah, God's chosen one."
When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3:00, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Then Jesus uttered a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion, who stood facing him, saw that he thus breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was the Son of God."